Good morning. Good morning. Can you hear me? Morning. Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you, Hou Chen. Any questions before we formally start? Okay, today's lab tutor will talk about additional, we call bonus assignment. Basically, that's related to the page mapping. Okay, so please join the lab if you want to do that bonus assignment. Okay, so basically he will discuss a simple mapping. Provide some code for you to start, okay. Okay, so any questions? The next week, you don't need to come, right? We are in reading week. Then after that, we have two more weeks. We focus on concurrency. So any questions? Assignment week, yes, okay. Yeah, reading week, right? I think that's perfect time for you to write some code. So you have a continuous unblocked time, right? So you can focus on the writing code, right? Yeah, reading week has become working week. Okay, so so can you guys see my screen? Dangerous code here. Hello guys, can you see the dangerous code, this slide? Okay, thank you. So yesterday actually we introduced this interface. Actually, we talk about the return value. Then we also provide two examples over there. So all those programs have been released. You can play those programs. Then after you play, then you will understand what I'm talking about. Generally speaking, in C, when we go to the pointer, then you only need to remember two issues. Either we handle the value stored in this pointer, or we handle the address of this pointer. Okay, so for example, if we have pointer, I may use this one. If we have pointer here, suppose integer pointer P, okay? So basically at P is for P's address, okay? P's value is for the value stored at P, okay? So that's it. Then we also talk about like how to return value as well. So today let's look at another program. So this is the program we talk about, right? So basically, we provide the address of M, okay? Then we return the address related to a structure. We use the malloc to allocate the space, right? So for MA, MB here, so but for R, right? So we malloc this based on this this structure by return, right? Then when we do malloc, actually we generate a variable from the, we return the address locate in heap, okay? Then this address of the variable allocated through malloc will be returned, right? So we'll start into M because we gave the address for M. So basically M, suppose this is the address of M. M means address, okay? The value will be stored is R. Okay, so R will be point to X and Y. So we can print out MX and MY. Okay, so that's what we discussed. We also provide one example, see if we want to, yeah, so the, can you hear me? Hello guys, because I got a pop-up message say that internet is not stable. Yeah, okay. Yeah, so maybe let me change the network. So use my 5G network. It's more stable. One second. Okay, one second, let me switch to this network. I could not find it, okay. Where's my... Okay, it's not here somehow. Okay, so maybe let's continue, right? So because we only have 45 minutes, okay. Let me try last one more time. Somehow it could not find it. I don't know why. Yeah. Okay, so can you guys see my screen now? Hello guys. Okay, thank you. So let's continue. Okay, so basically we talk about this. So one issue related to this return value is we need to be careful. For example, this is code is very dangerous. So you can see here, we have a local variable R here, then we have RX, RY, right? Then we return the address of R. Okay, so remember local variable actually is located on the stack frame, right? So when we call this function, then we allocate the local variable in the stack frame for this function. Then when we return from this function, we will release that stack frame. So do you understand what I'm talking about? Basically, this part of the memory will be released. So R will be released, right? So when we return from this function, actually it is automatically deallocated. Basically, this part of memory is not used anymore. We release this, we exit from this stack frame. So, it may happen, okay? So we have a segment fault, okay, in this case, okay? Because we release this, okay? So this kind of a code is dangerous. But remember, when we use malloc, why it works? The reason is that heap is shared among different threads. However, each thread has its own stack, right? So basically, when we allocate a variable through the heap, then those variables can be shared because they are kind of a global variable, right? It's shared among different threads. However, local variables are on the stack. Okay, after we exit from a particular function, actually that the corresponding stack frame will be deallocated. Okay, then we don't have this space anymore. We don't have this variable anymore, right? So this is one thing we need to be careful. The following two slides are related to the flexibility for how can we pass value and return value. For example, if we want to pass the value with an integer, then we can do it. If we want to return integer, we can do it, right? So I will show you some code here to see how this happened. Okay. Particularly, you can see that if you want to pass integer, then this shows flexibility in C. You can pass this value, then you can force the type conversion to be void star. Okay, so which means 100, this is the value, but you treat this as a pointer without type, okay? Then after you get this value from arg variable from this function, okay, then you can convert this into the integer. You can, because this value, this is what I'm talking about. In C, you get a variable, it's up to you to treat this value as an address or as a value, okay? So here, although the type is a pointer, then actually we can treat this as an integer. So we just treat it as an integer, convert this integer, then we can print out the return value. Return this value back, okay? Then here we give the address of M, then store the result into M. Okay, then you can directly, you look at here, M is a pointer, but you can directly point the value of M stored in M, okay? It's okay, yeah. So basically this is a, if you want to do this kind of a passing, it's allowed in C. This is not part of this pthread. Okay, this is a part of the feature of C language. Basically, when you call function, you can pass value like this. Okay, so next one, let's look at lock. So we talk about how to protect those shared variables. Use a critical section. So basically when we enter into a critical section, we can use a lock, okay? So in pthread actually, we can use this interface. When we enter into a critical section, we can call pthread mutex lock, okay? That gives our doc variable, okay? Then after we finish, and exit from the critical section, we can call pthread mutex unlock, given the lock variable. That's it. Okay. So if no other thread holds the lock, when we call pthread mutex lock, okay, then this thread call this function pthread mutex lock will acquire the lock and enter the critical section. Otherwise, if another thread holds the lock already, so which means one thread already entered into this critical section called this lock, this thread, when we call this P thread mutex lock, will not return from call until it has acquired the lock. Okay, basically, when you call this a program, a process, call this P thread mutex lock, this thread will wait until the lock will be acquired. Okay. Otherwise, we just wait over there. Okay. If we call this function, right? So, in terms of how we implement lock, okay, we'll talk about next. Basically, because it's an operating system course, so we need to provide lock. Okay. So people can utilize our lock to enter into the critical section, right? So we'll talk about this in detail later. So another very important issue is that before we use lock, we need to initialize this lock, okay? So we can use two ways. One way is directly use this micro pthread mutex initializer, okay? So generally speaking, you just declare a variable log, then call this micro, then this micro will automatically do initialization for us. Or you can use this function called pthread mutex init, then give the address and so on, okay? Then if you have some attributes you can input, okay? Then you need to assert whether or not this is a succeed. Okay, if succeed, then you continue, right? So generally speaking, they are equivalent to each other. This micro will help us do this kind of stuff, okay? So if you use textbook code, actually textbook provides some code over there, then they already wrap up all those functions by capitalize the first P when we go to those API function. So from the, you look at here, P, right? So actually the wrapper function is like this. Generally speaking, we just assert we succeed after we call those functions. Okay, so this is a wrapper function. So basically they provide some header and wrapper function. So you can directly use this capital P kind of function to do initialization lock and so on. So you don't need to check whether or not this function is successfully executed, something like that, okay? Okay, so before I continue, let me go back to the program, okay? So let me run several program here, then you can see what we discussed here. So first is, let me show you the integer, right? So you can see here, basically, if we want to input the integer, we just put this void star, say false is become a pointer. Okay, so this step is used to satisfy the prototype here. Then when we call this function, use a pthread, then when we enter here, then we just directly use this as an integer. It's okay. Then finally, I think maybe the code here is I equal to I. I think it should be okay because it's void. Then we can print out or something like that. So let me run this. This is not a good code, okay? You can see here, we don't have a type here for this I. It's not good. but I just want to show you that basically it's very flexible. It passes the parameter in C language. Okay, I guess this is the first one. Second, I want to run that thread concurrency, right? This one. So remember we have a program counter, right? So basically we use this as a motivation. Now let's go back to make sure this program can run properly and use the lock. So you can see here, this is how we, first we have a counter here, then we do this initialization for this lock, pthread lock. Then before, actually when we enter into the critical section, do this counter plus plus, we didn't do any, we just allow this, everyone can access this, right? Two thread can access this without a critical section. But counter plus plus is our critical section. We need to guarantee this counter plus plus is executed in an atomic manner. So this is why we put this lock to protect this critical section, okay? So generally speaking, when we enter this critical section, just use the lock, okay? After we exit, unlock, that's it, right? So other part, now you can understand, it's very simple. You can see that we create a P1 and a P2, two thread, use worker without any input, any return value. Then, in our main function, main thread here, basically we wait P1 to be finished, P2 to be finished. And finally we print out the value, right? So in this way, actually we can guarantee counter plus plus will be executed in an atomic manner. Then basically we can guarantee the result will be correct because we only have two workers, then that's, when we do this counter plus plus, we can guarantee only one thread can enter into this critical section. So we are okay, yeah. So I just want to show you how this works, okay? So after the reading week, the tutor will give you a detailed tutorial related to how to run pthread. And so I'll give you more introduction about this and some exercise also. Okay, I guess that's all for this part. I noticed there are some questions. Okay, but let me finish the slides, then I will go back to answer your question. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, so next one. We can, when we acquire lock, we can also try use the different API. For example, this API called TryLock. Okay. TryLock is like, I will try to acquire this lock. If lock already held by others, okay, I will return failure immediately. I don't want to wait, okay. TryLock. So in terms of why, we need this kind of function. Okay, later will be clear because this can avoid deadlock. Okay, so yeah, deadlock is a major issue when we have a concurrency, concurrent programming. Okay. Particularly if I hold A, then you hold B, then I want to get, yeah, so maybe, it's sometimes language always very poor to describe the meaning, right? So suppose we have two resources, A and B, right? Okay, so I'm the P1, you are the P2, okay? Suppose I already obtain, because I want to log I want to get both A and B in order to continue, right? So then I first get log of A, right? Then I try to get, I send a request, say, hello B, okay? I want to lock you. However, P2 already get lock B, okay? Then P2 say, okay, I need A to continue. You can see here, we have dialogue, right? A is acquired by P1, then P1 is waiting for B. B is acquired by P2. P2 is waiting for A. Okay, so you see, this is the circle here, right? Circular rate, we call, okay. So trilog can help us to solve this issue, right? For example, I get this one, I get A, I try B, then I failed, okay? Then I will say, okay, maybe I cannot do this, okay? So I will immediately return. So we will don't have this one, okay? Then similarly, B, P2 also, thread two also, already got B, then try lock A, cannot, okay? Just return immediately, okay? But in order to make this program work, so this program still, although we don't have a log, we don't have a dialogue, but we may have a live log. You can see here, right? So if no one wants to release results, then maybe after a while, then P1 will try again, then P2 will try again, right? Then if no one releases the results A or B, then basically we cannot move forward. But there's no dialogue, right? But we have leave log here. So no one can move forward. We just try those function over there. Okay. We'll talk about those issues later, okay? But the trilog at least can help us to avoid this kind of a dialog to some degree. For example, we can have P1 and P2 follow the same order. They always need to get A, then get B, right? Then in this way, P1 get A, then P2 try to get A, then cannot, okay, P2 will fail. Then P1 will get B, then basically P1 can continue and so on, right? So trilog at least can help us to solve this problem, okay? It's better than a directly way. Okay. Another way is a timeout log. So the idea also is very simple. So basically we can give a time. So you can input the time. So I just want to wait for 5 seconds, for example. So after this 5 seconds, I will return fail if I could not get it. Okay. So we'll talk about those issues, okay, basically. How to utilize those to solve the dialog issue. Conditional variable will be discussed next time, okay? I will not talk about this because this is a very major part related to use a conditional variable to solve some classical concurrency problem, okay? So basically this is one of major tool we can utilize to solve the concurrency issue. Okay, so then let's talk about the compilation. So I hope you guys already see it. So if you want to utilize pthread, then you have to include this argument hyphen pthread when you compile. Otherwise it can, you will get you will be failed, okay? Please try it, then you know what I'm talking about, okay? If you want to know more information, you can use the menu to get the information, okay? So let me first summarize this part, then I will go back to answer some questions, then we move on to the log. So this part, actually, we talk about some motivation. So Then we talk about what is multiple threading. So basically, multiple threads share the same address space inside of one process, right? But with different stacks. Okay, of course, we also need different registers and so on, right? So if we have some shared variable, which will be accessed by multiple threads, then we may have race condition. Race condition means the result will be decided based on the access sequence. Okay, if we have different access sequence, then we have different result. Okay, so this is why we call race condition, right? So then to solve this, the idea is very simple. We can end the lock. When we enter the critical section, we just use lock. Lock this critical section, then make it mutual exclusive, which means at a particular time, only one thread can enter into this critical section. Okay. So then we introduce several API function, create thread, join thread, and lock and unlock. Okay, conditional variable will be introduced next time. Okay, so okay, so this is serve as an introduction for concurrency. Let me go back to let me go back to answer some questions. Okay, but what exactly is inside the destructure lock? Why will function not return zero? So are you talking about the lock itself? Okay, so we will talk about how to design log, okay, next time. Your question is very good, okay? So log is not easy to be designed. Log is very hard to design, okay? So we'll talk about this next time. But generally speaking, log is a kind of a variable over there that we need some hardware mechanism to help us to provide atomicity, then we can access that variable. Yeah. So a detail will be discussed next. Okay. Yeah. So next question, how does log know which variable to log? Okay. No. Log is a tool, right? Log is a function, right? So you are the programmer, right? You decide, okay? You decide where to put log. Okay, of course, this is why we have so many bugs when we do this multi-core program, concurrent programming, multiple threading, right, program. So because we don't have a way to put a log automatically, okay? So this is why we earn high salary, right? So you see, you just write a log over there, then of course everyone can input the log, but you know where to put the log, right? So that's a difference, yeah. I hope I answer your question, right? So basically this is why, okay? We have high salary, right? We know where to put the log. What is a wall, right? That's warning, right? Yeah. So basically, I think one student, Ken Lang, help me to answer, okay? All warning, it's not war, okay? It's warning, right? All warning, it's war, right? Okay, let me see. But if log can be designed differently, there will be compatibility issues. So what do we mean compatibility issues? Vanna, can you clarify your question? Give us a little bit a description about your question. So generally speaking, operating system need to provide lock. Okay, so this is some fundamental system call we need to provide. Compatibility issue, okay. So different architecture may have different way to implement this lock, of course. Compatibility. I don't know what do you mean compatibility. But generally speaking, OS need to provide this function, okay, for user to use. Okay. So we'll talk about this, okay, immediately. Okay, but that's a very good question. So you realize this is not easy, right? Okay, great, okay. So let's continue. Let me go to next topic. Where is my? Okay, so let me utilize this time of minutes to talk about lock, okay, because looks like you guys want to know lock, right? How we implement, right? So as we mentioned before, lock ensure the critical execution as atomic operation, right? For example, if you want to give me $1 million, then we have to put the lock over there, right? So make sure we can finish, right? In an automatic manner. So basically, lock has two states. Each lock variable has two states. Either is free, or we call it available unlock free. So which means this lock, no one hold this lock is free, right? Or this is acquired, locked, held, okay? So in that state, exactly one thread holds the lock and basically we assume we are into a critical session. As I mentioned, okay, this where to put lock is our job. So what is the semantics of the lock? Okay, so first we try to acquire the lock. When we use lock, we try to acquire lock. Then if no other thread holds the lock, then thread will acquire the lock immediately. Okay, enter the critical session. Then basically this thread is the owner of the lock. Okay, then I enter the critical session, then I can do something inside of the critical session. Okay. If the lock is not free, then other thread are prevented from enter the critical session. Well, the first thread that hold the lock is inside, basically. So other thread will be prevented, okay? Will be put into a waiting state until the lock is released, is unlocked. So pthread lock, we call it a mutex, okay? So it's because lock, mutex means mutual exclusion, right? So this is a common name for the zero and one lock, right? So only allow one thread to enter into lock, right? So Generally speaking, you can see this is how we use a pthread initializer to initialize this lock, then we can use it. So a major issue is how to optimize the performance when we have a lock. So basically, you think about lock is what? Lock is, suppose I have a 10th thread, can execute the code, okay? Can execute the same piece of code. Then everyone can, if there's no lock, right? No critical session. So this piece of code can be executed by 10 thread concurrently, then wonderful. If I have 10 cores, then we may process data 10 times faster than one thread. However, whenever we have a critical session, we have log, you have one log. Log actually force the access become sequential. Think about that. Because everyone need to acquire the log, then enter the critical session, then finish, release the log, then next one can come in. So whenever we have a log, then our execution become sequential. Sequential execution. There's no parallel anymore, right? So this is why we commonly used approach is a fine-grained approach. Okay, so go to the textbook. So there's a chapter to tell us how to design different data structure to like to optimize the performance. Of course, the simplest way is you just block everything. Okay, for example, you have a linked list. You want to suppose this linked list is shared among multiple threads. Then, in order to guarantee your program can run properly, can run correctly, then you can put a lock to lock the whole list, right? That's the simplest way. Or you can have fine-grained method. Say, okay, maybe we can only lock a particular item, for example, head or tail. Then for a particular kind of function, it's good enough or something like that. Okay, so go to the textbook. You can find out a whole chapter talk about this. Okay, so this is also part of, this is also a research topic. So how to optimize a concurrent program. But anyway, the purpose of this slide is related to how to design a lock, okay? So because we are operating system, we are operating system designer, right? So yeah, we have to provide lock mechanism so user program can utilize our lock. So the purpose here is that we want to provide a mutual inclusion at a low cost, right? You can see that we need a hardware help, okay, in order to achieve this. So when we design lock, our basic criteria is, we have three basic criteria. The first one, mutual inclusion. So this is our function. If we cannot guarantee this, then forget about it, okay? This is the basic function. So basically, we want to provide mutual inclusion for entering a critical session. Okay, if we have log, we have to provide this function. Okay, second, it should be fair. We should prepare fairness. So fairness means if a thread want to compete for the lock, okay? So we should have a fair chance to get it, okay, once this lock is free, okay? On the contrary, if we don't have fairness, then maybe one thread waiting for a particular lock will never get it, okay? Then in that case, we call it a starvation, okay? Then of course, after we consider the correctness and the fairness, we also need to consider performance. You may say that, okay, my method is very fair. My method can provide this mutual inclusion. However, it's very, very slow. Then no one will use your solution, right? So we want to make sure we can very efficiently to implement the lock, okay, without introduce a lot of work. Then go back to this very simple method of control interrupt, okay? So basically, earliest solution is use a disable interrupt. Okay, I think this is also the first idea maybe in your brain when you talk, when you say, okay, so how about we just allow those thread to be executed without interrupt? Because when interrupt occurs, then we may do the scattering, right? So the problem is that, okay, so first issue, this only works for the single process system, okay? When we have multiple process, okay, usually it's very hard to, like to, of course we can always say you want to like disable the interrupt for all processes. We do have this mechanism, but the overhead is too much, okay? Then also, we need to give the trust to the application. So if, for example, if we have a single processor, we disable the interrupt, then we enter into this application program. Then inside this application program, it will never enable interrupt anymore. Then basically this program can run forever because based on the interrupt, we do the scattering, okay? Now, if we put this kind of a trust into this kind of a disable mechanism in for the user, then user can control it. Then basically, we may not regain the control for the system, okay? So for as I mentioned, it cannot work for the multiple processors, okay? And also to control the interrupt actually is slow, okay? So basically this is not the solution. So most important thing is that our scheduling mechanism is based on the interrupt, okay? So basically you cannot use this one, okay? For the, for this concurrent program. Okay. So this one need a little bit more time to understand, but the general idea is maybe say that you will say, oh, okay, it's so simple. I can design a log. You can see here, right? So for example, my log structure is like this, okay? Inside I have integer, right? Then initialization is just to make it become zero. Then when I log, I just try to see if this value is one, then I will wait, okay? Then if this becomes zero, then I get it, okay? Then I log is just release it, right? So however, you can see that if we have interrupt occur, then basically we may have a concurrency issue because this log is shared among different threads. We want to utilize this to provide atomicity. Definitely, it may not work, okay? So anyway, I will discuss this after reading week. Okay, I hope you guys enjoy reading week. Yeah, write code is always something, right? Which is very relaxed, right? To give you a lot of pressure, pleasure, right? I assume, right? Okay, so anyway, that's all for today's lecture. So if you have any questions, then please input your question into the chat box. If you have other important thing, now you can leave now. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Let me copy all those questions. Yeah. So. Okay, show a warning. So this part, let me remove. If log can be designed differently, so I think I already talked about this. I already addressed this compatibility issue. Yeah, so basically, we have to provide this function, but as long as the function is the same, it's okay actually. Yeah. Can we access OS provide functions through any language or only C? Okay, of course, any language, right? So OS provide system call. Right, this is a function. I assume this function you talk about, right? OS function, right? So, which can be called, which can be utilized by all different language. Of course, all different kind of language, right? But the C is very suitable for the system level programming because the C actually, you think about that, those pointer is very similar to the like a machine representation for our phoneme architecture, right? So we know the address, we know the value, right? Those kind of stuff. So usually in high level language, other language, you don't have such flexibility, okay? Yeah, so could you explain why disable interrupt? So generally speaking, you can think about, suppose I have multiple processor, right? Multiple processor, then if you disable interrupt, you can only disable one processor, right? You cannot disable multiple one at the same time. So this is the why, okay, it cannot work. But if we only have a single processor, it's possible, right? You can do this disable, okay? But for multiple, you cannot, generally speaking, okay? Okay, but it's impossible. For multiple processors. Yeah, look like not easy design log. Yeah, you are right. Okay. So this is why we will spend some time to talk about. Yeah. Your feeling is very correct. Okay. Log is not easy. Log is not easy to be designed. Okay. As a shield like a simple function. No. Log is not easy function. Log is a system call provided by the system, by open system. A question about swap. If a page is swapped into the disk, will the corresponding entry in TLB be erased? I think that's a very good question, okay? So I think in that case, maybe we need to flush our TLB, right? So which means, because the mapping, for this mapping, actually, let me see, okay. Yeah, you are right, okay. So if a page is swapped into disk, will the corresponding entry be? Yes, okay. We should flush this mapping. We should remove, right? Remove this match from here, right? Otherwise, we will utilize this to do the mapping. We don't have this physical memory. We don't have this physical page. This page already in the disk, right? So basically, we have to evoke this mapping. Yeah, you are right. Very good question. Okay, so I see what is meant by test the log in. So let me copy some question here, see whether or not I can copy those questions. Yeah. So how other language English? So actually, I don't know when I'm, okay, it's a very good question, but I have no idea for other language. But generally speaking, system call is very simple. No matter what kind of language, in the end, you need to compile them into machine code. As I mentioned before, system call, we have some special function. We have some special instruction. Yeah, basically we have a special instruction called trap. Okay, then we operating system define. Okay, operating system define the system call number. Then you just do mapping. Okay, you can write a library, then. But in your language, for example, you use Java, then you call those functions, then you can still use it, okay? Connect with your system call, then get the file and so on. Yeah. But usually this will be implemented through a library function. So for a particular language, they will provide a library function for you to use, okay? So in terms of specific language, this is very complicated, okay? Different language. Because some language is interpretation based on virtual machine and so on. So yeah, it's hard to give you a very general answer. But generally speaking, you can use a library. Then when you implement, just call that the library function, then this already trapped into the kernel. Yeah. We cannot this, yeah, I think so. So we cannot disable all process interrupt. I think we cannot disable all processor interrupt at one time to make them all accurate. Okay, you cannot do this at one time, okay? Maybe you can do it, okay? You disable this, disable this, disable this, okay? But you cannot do this at one time. So generally speaking, you cannot make it in an atomic manner, okay? Then basically, if you cannot do this in an atomic manner, then you cannot say provide atomic operation, right? Something like that. Right? What is mean by test the flag, okay? So I will talk about this test flag, but generally speaking, that's log, right? Log need to provide the function, right? So the flag is used to record whether or not the log has be held, okay, something like that, okay? So of course, we'll talk about this in detail next time. You guys ask very good question, okay? Very detailed, where is this system, okay? You guys are good system guy. But the flag log seems not good. Yeah, you are right, okay? Yeah, so basically this may not work, right? So it's not good actually. Use this way, it cannot work. So next time we'll talk about a proper way to generate, to design log. This first example actually is a buggy implementation. Okay, you cannot use this one to implement the log. Okay, so I guess maybe that's all for today's lecture. So any other questions? Okay, then have a good reading week, right? Or working week. Okay, don't forget today's lab. Okay, see you after the reading week. Bye-bye.